And so when you see that word macroeconomy, you wrote it nice and big, chapter 4, what comes to mind? What's the first thing that kind of pops into your mind in terms of thinking macro?
Big.
Yes. Okay, so we're looking at learning outcomes. There's quite a few here, so I think it's worthwhile just to go through them, and then we'll see what we need to focus on here.
So we're in about chapter 4 and 5, okay?
Yes, we're almost there. Okay, good. Learning outcomes?
So the determinants of
aggregate.
Aggregate, what is that?
Aggregate means total. Okay. Like everything combined, total.
Okay. The determinants of aggregate demand and aggregate supply and the shape of their curves. How changes in the price level are measured, money level, money values, and real values. The cause and consequences of inflation, deflation, and disinflation. The components of the balance of payments. Sorry. The distinction between a balance of payments, equilibrium, and disequilibrium. The cause and consequences of balance of payments. Disequilibrium, definitions of different types of exchange rates, the determination of different exchange rates in different exchange rate systems, the cause and consequences of exchange rate changes, what is meant by the term of trade and how the terms of trade can be established, the cause and consequences of changes in the terms of trade, the distinction between absolute and comparative advantage, the benefits of trade, of free trade, the main characteristics of free trade areas, customer unions and economic unions, the method of and agreements in favor of protectionism.
Right, so looking at all those points, do you all agree they actually talk about things outside the business?
Yeah.
Not so much things inside the business. They talk about trade. They talk about aggregate demand.
Yeah.
Aggregate means?
Total.
Everything combined in terms of demand. So let me ask you this. As an individual, do we demand goods and services?
Yeah.
Yes, but do other people as well?
Yeah.
Yes. So aggregate means we're going to take all of those perceived preferences and we're going to combine it into one. Right, that's why you've got macro economy here. Macro means
big. So I think of macro like the store. It's like a big store.
Yes, that's a good way of remembering it. So micro means small, macro means big. And micro is looking at the business in terms of what will it do and how will it be affected by the economy. Here we look at macro, where we look at all the businesses, we're looking at all the suppliers, we look at all the actual customers, and we're looking at, well, having aggregate demand and aggregate supply, where should the market be operating? Okay, so it's just high level, that's all.
Yeah.
Right, so we're moving more away from the micro in terms of like looking at the business, and we're looking more at a bigger picture. Okay, that's what the macro economy is looking at. So let's define that. Macro economy, they should have given a, yeah, they did. Right, there's the definition. Economy as a whole, meaning everything. Economy as a whole, bracket all the consumers and suppliers. It's everything. That's the macroeconomy. Right, so whenever you see the word macro, just think of holistic. It's everything. Okay, like you said, the macro store sells everything.
Yeah.
Right, they sell food, they sell clothing, they sell bedding, they sell
dog food.
Dog food, outdoor stuff, indoor stuff, electronics, you name it, they've got it.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's what we look at. We look at everything. So macroeconomy, everything combined. Now, just to summarize, the textbook said the macroeconomy is the economy as a whole. That's how they described it in terms of the definition. Just a bit more depth in the actual paragraph, they say, the level of activity in the economy is determined by the interaction of aggregate demand and aggregate supply. See, those words are important. So I'm going to write that down in terms of this definition. Aggregate demand and aggregate supply is analyzed. analyzed.
Is that like part of the definition?
Yeah, it's part of it, because you're looking at everything holistically. Okay, so I'm just going to add that here in a bracket. That's kind of what you're focusing on here. So when we look at macro, it's always going to be high level, and it's always going to be everything combined, okay, totals. Okay, so the first thing we need to look at is change in demand and supply. We need to look at the economic graphs again, but now for aggregate demand and aggregate supply. So you can see the graphs are slightly different. They're not completely straight because you're looking at total, the aggregates. Right, so number one, aggregates, big heading, demand. That's the first graph that you've got in your book. Yeah, aggregate, maybe just make a side note. Aggregate means total, everything combined.
So now we're going to talk about aggregate demand.
Yes, okay, so aggregate demand consists of four components: consumption, investment, government spending, and net exports. Right, so what does aggregate demand look like? Well, let's just put a side note to it. Aggregate demand means the total demand from all players, or role players, let's use the word role players, in the economy. Okay, so let me ask you this. Do only consumers buy goods?
No.
Who else would buy goods?
Suppliers.
Yes, demand can be from both sides. Okay, the supply and the demand. Would government buy goods?
Yeah.
Yes. Would other countries buy goods?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, and that's what they're talking about here. They're talking about these four components. Right, so let's put a heading for that. Four components. Components. This is a side note, a separate subheading. The first one is consumption. C for consumption. You'll see a formula later on, probably, because they're talking about aggregate demand. Consumption, which is consumer expenditure. All consumer expenditure. Let's put that word as well. Okay, so does that first part make sense? We've got aggregate demand. Aggregate means the total, taking everything into consideration. If I'm looking at the different components of aggregate demand, the first one is consumption from the consumer. So all consumer expenditure, everything that comes from them. Right, so not only you, me, but every single person in this country would create a aggregate demand. Right, so we're not looking at the individual, we're not looking at the business. We're looking at every single individual, every single business, okay, in terms of consumption. Right, that's what aggregate is in terms of the total. Very different to normal demand. Normal demand is a straight line. Aggregate demand, you'll see, is a curve.
So is normal demand just looks at the
micro
consumer?
Yeah, microeconomics is looking at the consumer of the product.
Yeah.
What do they want? How much do they want? What price do they want it?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what you're looking at. Here, we're looking big picture. We're taking all those consumers and we're grouping them together and saying, well, what is the aggregate demand for those consumers? Okay, one component is the consumption for a consumer. That's only the first one. There are three more. The second is investment. Investment. And that comes from the suppliers. That's private sector firms. That could be a supplier. Private sector firms. Let's use the right wording. Private sector firms. Right, so private sector firms would be buying and selling certain assets. Okay, well, if they're investing, they're buying. Right, if they're selling, then they're divesting. Can you remember the word divest means to pull out investment, okay, not to invest in the actual company or products, okay, depending on what they're buying. Right, the next one, C, is government spending, government G. Okay, governments spend money on what? Public goods and services, do you agree?
Yeah.
Right, so if they're going to build that road, if they're going to build those street lights, if they're going to build public hospitals, public facilities, are they going to require resources?
Yeah.
Yes. So government is also part of the demand, and they make up the aggregate as well. Right, that's what we look at. We look at the different sections of government, investment, private sector, and consumption, people, households. Right, so government spending, that's G. This is looking at spending or demand. Demand arising from public goods and services, public goods slash services.
So are these four components what makes up aggregate demand?
Yes, that's right. Okay, so we're obviously looking at the components, i.e. what makes it up. So these are components that make up the total. Because remember we said not only one person demands goods, right? There's multiple. And these are the groups that they use to add up and calculate the aggregate demand. Right, the last one, D, is net exports. Brackets, they use a formula X minus M here. We'll see it later on when we look at the whole equation. This is the difference between the value of exports and imports. So, difference between exports and imports. That's what we're looking at. Okay, so now we need to describe the graph.
Can you just write this down?
Yeah, no problem. We need to describe the graph just now once you've got that. Alright, so we're going to the demand graph. I'm just going to take one from before. Let's just use that. Okay, let's first make a few more slides. Right, so what does the graph look like? Well, you're going to have to draw a slight curve here. It's not a straight line, it's a curve. And it's a curve sloping downwards. Okay, so something kind of like that.
So why is aggregate demand a curve and normal demand just a straight line?
Yeah, because if you look at multiple things, there could be certain differences between what's demanded and supplied, and that's why it's not perfect. Okay, straight means perfect. Right, so perfect meaning if the price rises by X, the quantity is going to rise by X, or actually drop because it's indirect, remember? It's sloping down. So now, if I have a price of, let's say, 100 here, and if I decrease the price, I would expect demand to increase. Okay? If I increase the price, I would expect the demand to decrease. Okay, that's the relationship. So if you've got a curve, it means it's not perfect. It's an expectation of what the market is going to or how the market is going to react to a change in price depending on its preference. So remember, does government have to buy public goods and services? Or does the government have to provide us with public goods and services? Definitely. So would they have to buy those goods irrespective of price? Definitely. But would a consumer? No. So do you agree that the demand for government would be more inelastic compared to the demand for a for government? So the demand for government would be more inelastic than the demand for a consumer. Okay, because they still need to provide us with those public goods and services.
Yeah,
so let's talk about government providing books and stationery to schools. Okay, and they do that. So I remember when I was like in grade one, I went to Glenanda, which is just up the road, and there they actually used to give us like school books. Like we never had to buy our own stationery. Obviously, you had to buy your own pens and pencils and things like that, but the actual physical books, they used to give it to us. Why? It's part of government. So government does that a lot. They provide schools with a certain amount of stationery. Some you would have to buy, some they provide. But does government have to provide that? Yes. And that's why the demand in terms of government spending would be almost inelastic, because it doesn't matter how the prices change, they would still have to buy those items. Right, but consumers won't be as affected. Right, and that's why it's a curve, not a straight line. Okay, because if it's a straight line, what does that mean?
It's perfect.
Straight line means it's perfect, meaning if I decrease the price, I'm going to increase the demand. Okay, but it's going to be a perfect relation. And nothing's ever perfect when looking at
macro.
Macro is big. Okay, big picture. But you'll never ever be able to measure the macroeconomic aggregate demand 100% accurately.
Yeah.
Right, so because there's that room for discrepancy in terms of price and demand, it's a downsloping graph. Okay, and it looks like that. There's it. The aggregate demand curve. Notice what they use though. Do I use quantity? No, I use GDP, okay, domestic product. Okay, so we need to label these as well.
Can I just go get my pencil to draw the graph here? Sorry, I don't have
okay.
my pencil here.
Okay. Yeah. All right, I'll label it along. Okay, so that's what you need to draw. Okay, it's the same as figure 4.1 in the textbook. But then we need to write up a few notes relating to this graph. Right, so they obviously talk about reasons, okay, in terms of the rise and the fall of demand. Okay, and they kind of explain it in the paragraph. So first thing is obviously to understand what the graph looks like. It's not a straight line, it's a curve. And the curve has two things: price level and real GDP. Okay, I'm gonna actually add a word here, aggregate demand, like that. Okay, so aggregate means the total demand. So taking those four characteristics and summarizing into one graph, one picture, like that. Okay. The textbook then talks about why does aggregate demand fall when the price level rises and vice versa. Right, so do you agree for one customer, we can explain it in terms of preference and we can explain it in terms of inelastic or elastic. But now we're not talking about one customer, we're talking about multiple. We're talking about everybody. We're talking about the consumers, the government, the net exports, and the investments. Okay, so there's four different role players that are going to affect the aggregate demand. So what are the different impacts? Well, let's identify it. Okay, well, obviously, aggregate demand, AG still slopes down because A, the wealth effect, that's the first consideration. So why does the graph slope downwards? Well, the wealth effect is the first reason. What
so
is the wealth?
I'm just going to write a small note here. So the graph is a curve because all components are different.
Because you're looking at all four components in one graph. And it's not a perfect relationship. There's no perfection in looking at the total, the big picture.
So the graph is a curve because all four components are different.
Well, all four components are combined to make one graph.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so the wealth effect is dealing with this. A rise in the price level reduces the amount of goods and services that people's wealth can buy. The purchasing power of savings held in the form of a bank account and other financial assets will fall. Right, so the wealth effect is basically looking at buying power. That's the focus. Right, and what do I mean by buying power? Well, do you agree the more wealthy you are, the more buying power you have and the more options you have because you can choose very, very different items versus someone who doesn't? Okay, so that's why they're looking at this. They talk about the consumer's needs for goods and wants will relate to the buying power of those individuals. Okay, so if you have more buying power, you'd be able to purchase more and you would then be more inelastic to a change in demand. Okay, changing price. Even if price had to change, if you're wealthy and you've got more buying power, you would still buy certain items irrespective. Okay, which is quite different to other people. So that's what they're talking about here. They're talking about the rise in price level will reduce the amount of goods and services that people's wealth can buy. And so obviously, if prices had to increase, it's going to affect our buying power. So if it affects our buying power, it would therefore slope downwards. Some people's buying power might be affected by more than others. Okay, just depends on where you are in terms of your wealth.
So if I had to write their wealth,
just use two examples. Rich would still buy, poor wouldn't. The graph therefore won't be straight. Simple. Okay. Because you're looking at everybody, you look at the rich and the poor, and you're grouping them as one, and you're showing one graph that represents both of them. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, the next one is the international effect. That's the next one. International obviously looks at outside the country. Here they say, a rise in the price level will reduce the demand for net exports as exports will become less price competitive, while imports become more price competitive. Right, so that's a rise in price will reduce demand for net exports. Reducing demand for net exports, meaning exports will become less price competitive, while imports will become more price competitive. So I'm just gonna simplify that. International effect, imports and exports. Will be affected by that. Okay, so do you agree? Different countries provide different goods, right?
Yeah.
Some countries provide better goods, some countries provide cheaper goods. So that's something to consider in terms of imports and exports.
Better prices.
Possibly, or more options. Okay, so here they're talking about imports and
exports.
They're saying if the prices has to rise, okay, the exports will become less price competitive. Okay, exports meaning we are going to be taking goods outside the country, we're going to be selling it to other places. Right, but they said less competitive, meaning the rising of the prices have risen. Right, so let's use an example. South Africa produces a lot of fruits and vegetables, okay, because we've got lots of land. Okay, so let's talk about a farmer. If a farmer is going to export meaning take those goods outside the country and sell it to another country.
Yeah.
So if we're exporting apples, okay, if the price level had to rise, so if prices for apples had to increase, what is that going to do to our competitiveness by exporting goods? Will we be more or less competitive?
We'll
be less competitive. Why?
Yeah, the larger price.
Because now the prices are higher. So now we need to now almost deal with higher prices, and not everybody's going to buy at higher prices. So other countries in the world are going to think twice buying from your country if your country has increased the price levels for apples. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, then the opposite. They said a rise in price will make imports more competitive. So now what are we doing? We're importing goods.
Yeah.
So do you agree, if we're buying cars from other countries, and let's say the prices of all those vehicles had risen. So let's say the price of the vehicle was 100 and now the price of the vehicle is 150. Okay? What's that going to do to the import competitiveness? It's going to increase it. Why? Because if you're importing goods and now those goods are more expensive, you're going to be thinking twice about which supplier to use. Does it make sense?
Makes sense.
So you're going to actually try to find the right supplier to buy your goods from. It makes the imports more competitive because there's more competitiveness in the markets. Okay, that's what you're dealing with. Right, so remember, it's higher level thinking. Why? Because you're not looking at the business, you're looking at all the businesses. You're looking at everybody. You're looking at all the role players. That's why you're looking at imports and exports as a whole. Okay, so if the prices are to rise, we'll either be more or less competitive. Does it make sense?
That makes
sense. Okay. C is interest rate effect. And obviously, if you look at interest rates, we're looking at currencies. Okay, different places offer different rates. So here they said, the rise in the price level will increase demand for money to pay the higher prices. This, in turn, will increase the interest rates. A higher interest rate usually results in a reduction in consumption and investment. Right, so rising prices will increase demand for money to pay the higher prices. That's what they're talking about. So the interest rate effect. So remember, we're looking at broad. So what will affect demand? Money. So what affects money? The interest rates. Okay, so if prices are to increase, a higher price level will increase the demand for money. In turn, this will increase the interest rates. Higher rates result in a reduction in consumption and investment. Okay, because people don't buy more if things are if money is more expensive. Okay, so for example, would you buy more houses and cars if the lending rate, the interest, was higher or lower? When would you buy more cars
and houses? Interest rate is lower.
Exactly. Right, it just makes sense because you're not going to want to pay more for the money that you're using to buy other things. Okay, so let's write that in. Interest rate effect, brackets. I want to summarize it so we just don't write too much. Let's use the word interest rates. So lending and rates. Or lending rates. Okay, and you can maybe add more to your notes. So we can write in your notes there on your summary, higher interest rates result in a reduction in consumption and investments. And that just makes sense. The higher the rates, the less cars and land and buildings are going to buy.
So the higher interest rates, therefore less consumption.
Less consumption and investments. Two things. Okay, so I'll consume less, but I'll also invest less. Because lending relates to longer term assets, so buying equipment, machinery, vehicles, land and buildings, etc.
Okay.
Right, the last bit here is AG shifts. So previously we looked at what shifts the demand and supply. Now we're looking at the demand and supply again, but now we're looking for aggregates.
But there's only three.
Yeah, there's only three. Okay. Okay, now you're changing focus, you're looking at shifts. So what would shift the
graph? How many are there?
Four.
Can you put it down?
Yes. Okay, so how do you shift the aggregate demand? Well, the first thing is consumption. Anything that affects consumption. So what could affect consumption? Increasing confidence would affect consumption. Another one. Cut in tax. Tax cuts. More wealth. What else did I give you here? More money. More money supply. And increase in population. Okay, so those are things that will shift the graph. Why? Because you'll either have more or less confidence. Tax cuts or less tax cuts, depending. Okay, so let's just discuss which way will you shift the graph. If I increase wealth, is demand going to rise or fall? If I increase wealth, is consumption going to rise or fall?
Rise.
It would rise. If I cut taxes, would income rise or fall?
Rise.
It would rise. Okay, so anything that puts more money in the consumer's pocket
mm-hmm.
is good for increasing demand. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, next page. Still carrying on with this whole idea, except we need more of these things. So, B. B is investments. All right, investment, a rise in business confidence, a cut in corporate tax, and advanced technology. All right, so this is business confidence, better or increased. Business confidence. Okay, cut or reduction, reduction in corporate tax, and the last one here was advances in technology. That is B.
Okay.
Right, so again, think about aggregate demand.
Yeah.
Right, if businesses have to pay less taxes, will they invest more or less?
If businesses have to pay more taxes, they invest less.
Less, okay, if they pay more taxes. If they pay less taxes, they would invest more. Makes sense?
Makes sense.
Okay, the third is government spending. Right, so let's think about government spending. What would affect it? Well, the first would be stimulating the economy. And the second is political reasons. Okay, here in the textbook, they use an example here of a campaign. Right, the desire to win a political campaign. Okay, gathering more support. Okay, so again, why does government do certain things? It's to influence the market, the people.
Yeah.
Right, and the last one is net exports. D, net exports. Okay, what influences this? Exchange rates is the first one. Quality of local goods versus international. So quality. And income abroad. Incomes abroad. Okay, so do people outside the country have more or less in terms of buying power? Okay, happy with that?
Yeah.
Perfect. Now we need to change focus. Aggregate supply now. Okay, so let's copy this. This is aggregate supply, so this needs to be supply now. Okay, aggregate supply, let's use red for this one. Okay, so aggregate demand, aggregate supply. AS still slopes up because, and then we'll define it, but aggregate supply is that way.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's a slope, it's a curve. All right, so that's what it looks like. There's it there, same thing. Okay, so we need to change this. It needs to slope this direction. And we need to label it. Okay, so it's still sloping up, but for the same reasons as before, it's a curve. Because we're not looking at one supply, we're looking at many. We're looking at everybody in the system. That's the key. Right, so again, draw a little graph like this, and then we need to discuss it and describe why it looks like this.
Oh, I don't think it is definitions first.
Yeah, definition first, you can write that down. But yeah, definitely draw the graph, and then we can explain it. Right, so let's look at the theory. I'll summarize that. Okay, so here they say, regarding aggregate supply, economists sometimes distinguish between short-run and long-run aggregate supply. So two different forms of supply here. Brackets, short-run, and long-run, AG. Yeah, so aggregate supply has short-run and long-run aggregate supply. Short-run aggregate supply is the output that will be supplied in a period of time when the prices or factors of production have not had time to adjust to changes in aggregate demand and the price level. Right, so there's the first part. Okay, so what does short-run refer to? Let's write that down. Short-run refers to changes in FOP, factors of production. Short-run aggregate supply is the output that will be supplied in a period of time when the prices of factors of production have not had time to adjust to changes in aggregate demand. Okay, so short-run refers to changes in factors of production when maybe just to summarize this, when no adjustment to aggregate demand has taken place yet. Where no adjustment in AD aggregate demand yet, as yet. Right, so that's what short run is referring to. Short run is referring to this, the factors of production. Okay, so remember who's producing? The supplier. So what's going to happen here? Well, the supplier will either produce more or less depending on factors of production. So if it's more expensive for them, will they produce more?
No,
probably not. Yeah, they'll probably produce less. If it's cheaper for them, they'll probably produce more. Right, so that's what you're looking at here. You're looking at short run refers to changes in factors of production with no adjustment in aggregate demand as yet. Okay, then you contrast long run aggregate
so
supply.
So what would be the like why to that, the explanation?
It's almost like a delay. It's almost like so if something happens, it takes a while for it to.
So it delays or increases in prices and affect factors of production.
Yeah, but remember it's a period of time when the price of factors of production have not had time to adjust to change in aggregate demand. Okay, so in other words, demand is not changing. Aggregate supply is adjusting, but it takes time to adjust. So now, if factors of production had to increase, so for example, if the price of petrol had to go up, would companies feel that effect immediately? No, they wouldn't. It will spill over because the effect of production would gradually increase over time. Okay, because let's say petrol becomes twice as expensive today. Okay, is that going to affect their supplier?
Yeah.
It would, but in the future, not quite now. So this is looking at a slight delay in terms of the impact. Okay, that's kind of what you're looking at. So if something happens to any other factors of production, let's say resources. So for example, let's say we're printing textbooks and paper becomes more expensive today. It wouldn't affect the demand yet until the prices have increased. Does that make sense? And that requires time. We're not going to just increase the textbook price by double, okay, just because the price of paper went up by double. Does that make sense? Okay, so short run is looking at what happens in the short term in terms of supply and demand. Okay, supply is looking at the production side of things. Demand is looking at the consumer side. Okay. In contrast, long run aggregate supply is the output that will be supplied in the time period when the price of factors of production have fully adjusted to change in aggregate demand. Okay, there we go. Next bit.
So long what can run. I shortly write there for why? I don't understand.
Let's give you a short summary. Let's think. Why?
Why does changes in factors of production in the short run affect the graph to slope?
We're not looking at the slope, we're just looking at two different forms of AS, aggregate supply.
But you said AS still slopes up because?
Okay, we haven't actually got there yet. This is just talking about these two time frames.
Oh, so we're not talking about this.
We are, but remember, it's short-term and long-term.
Okay.
Okay, so it's part of the shape, but just broken up into two sections. Okay, so you get the short-run aggregate supply, and you get short-run, long-run aggregate supply. Okay, you get two types of AS, aggregate supply. Okay, the one is referring to things that happen now and things that change now, which is short-run. And then the long-run is the things that change over a period of time. Okay, so I'm just trying to define those two things. Okay, then we'll talk about the shape just now. Okay. Okay, so long run refers to the outputs supplied when prices have fully adjusted to the changes again supply factors of production. Okay, so if FOP changes, we're looking at the actual total effect on it having affected it already. Okay, so not that progression, it's looking at what has happened after it has been implemented. Okay, now let's talk about the curve. So here they say the curve is upward sloping. So what we just said here, AS still slopes upwards. I'm going to highlight this, and then we'll put a note here at the bottom about it. Okay, so the methods here. Profit effects.
So this is what affects
the slope. Yes. Okay, so we need to understand what the aggregate supply refers to in terms of short run and long run. Now we look at the profit effects. Next one. Profit effect, we'll expand it just now. If there are only two, no, there's three. Cost effects. And the last one. Misinterpretation effects. Misinterpretation effect. Okay, so those are the three. I'm going to highlight those in red just so that that's clear. So AS still slopes upwards because of those three effects. Okay, let's describe each of them. Okay, so profit effect. Profit looks at what? Your income minus expenses, do you agree? Okay, that's the basic definition of profit. Here they said, as the price level increases, the price of factors of production such as wages do not change. So the price level rises, the gap between output and input prices widens, and the amount of profit increases. There's the profit effect. So why does the graph slope upwards? Because suppliers produce goods and they sell it at a specific price. So if the price level had to rise, what's going to happen to their profits?
Increase.
No, their profits can increase because they're selling. Okay, remember, suppliers sell. So that's what they're looking at there. So the profit effect is looking at greater income versus expenses. That's what they looked at. That's what they even said in the textbook. They said factors of production such as wages do not change. Okay, here's an example. You are running a business and you are paying your staff a fixed salary. Okay? You are selling petrol. And petrol prices have now gone up because the fuel price has gone up. Right, so are you going to sell petrol at a higher or lower price? Higher price. Right, so if you're selling petrol at a higher price, you're going to be making a higher profit. But do you still pay your workers the same? Yes. Okay, there's a supply graph. That's why they slope that way. Okay, that's why people supply more when prices go up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so if stationery becomes more expensive, more people are going to want to sell stationery.
Yeah.
Why? Because they can make more profits. Got that?
Okay.
Okay, that's the understanding. That's the example. Right, so next one, cost effect. Okay, cost relates to the expenses. Do you agree? Here they gave an example. Although the wage rates and raw materials remain unchanged in the short run, they can rise over the long run. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay, in the short run, you pay someone a certain salary. Okay, the longer they work in the company, the more likely you are to pay them more. That's over the long run. Then they say overpayments will have to be paid and costs will be involved to recruiting more members. To cover any extra cost that will involve in producing more output, producers will require higher prices. So, if you're running a business as a supplier, if you're going to supply more quantity, would you need more employees? Yes. And if you're buying, or if you're taking on more employees, will their wages go up? Probably. Why? Because there's more demand for those skills, or there's more demand for those people. Right, and that's what you're looking at here. That's what they're talking about. They're saying, as output increases, producers will have to pay raw wages. So the cost would increase. Right, so there's two things to consider here. The output, and then the required higher prices. So are we going to have to pay more to the employees? Yes. So would we have to charge more for our products and services? Yes, we would. Okay, and that determines that graph sloping upwards. So why does the graph slope upwards? It's because the more I produce, the more I have to charge, because it costs us to produce more. Make sense? Okay, so cost effects, brackets, the FOP. FOP rises, and so do the prices. And the last one, misinterpretation effects. What does it mean to misinterpret something? Misinterpretation.
Not understanding.
Exactly. So here they said, producers may confuse changes in the price level with changes in relative prices. They may think that a rise in the price they receive for their products indicates that their own product is becoming more popular. As a result, they may be encouraged to produce more. That's a problem. So misinterpretation effect is confusion. Right, and that's obviously the worst case scenario. Right, the business decided, oh, prices have gone up, so now I think people want more, so I keep producing more. Is that the case? No, it could be because of inflation. It doesn't have to be because of demand.
Yeah.
Okay, because they're separate. Demand is separate from supply. Supply is what we look at, demand is what we look at separately. So if we start mixing the two, it creates a problem. So this is the confusion, the misinterpretation. Producers may confuse changes in price levels with changes in relative prices. Okay, remember price level compared to change in price. So for example, can prices change? Yes. So let's talk about a special, okay, a promotion. Let's say one supplier, your competitor, your competitor chooses to put on this big promotion, 50% off everything in the store. Okay, and you're the competitor. So now what are you thinking? Ooh, my competitor decreased their prices by 50%. Should I also?
Maybe.
But if you do, it could be misinterpretation. Okay, or you might see, oh, my competitor increased the prices. Why? Well, it wasn't because people were demanding more. It might just be because that business was struggling. So that business had to increase prices to cover more of their costs. See, that's the cost effect. Right? So there could be various reasons why the graph is sloping upwards. Okay, one of the reasons could be misinterpretation. Okay, you viewed the information incorrectly. Got that? Okay. A little bit more complicated to think about here because it's aggregate. So that's the problem with these topics. It's aggregate. It's everything. All right. So new heading, new discussion point. Still looking at aggregate supply though. But now we're looking at the shifts. Shifts.
Can I look here?
There's four. Okay. Shifts in AES. Because the logic, you always start a new page. Okay, these last few chapters are quite in depth. So, let's see.
Yeah, we're not going to squeeze in inflation.
Yeah, inflation will probably go on the next page. They've got inflation being discussed here quite a bit. Balance of payments.
Yeah.
See, there's a lot here. Okay, so maybe just finish aggregate supply on the same page. And then the new topic start on a separate page. Okay, because there's still one, two, three, and then just summarizing the two.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's it. Okay, so let's talk about the shifts. What do you think will shift the supply graph? Okay, well, let's think about a consumer and a supplier. A supplier is going to produce more when what happens? See, you're looking at both demand and supply together. Okay, forget about the demand. Just think about the supplier. Okay, so you're a supplier. When would you supply more stationery?
When the costs are lower.
Exactly. There's the first one. Okay, so change in the price of factors of production. Changes in prices for FOP. There's the first one. Exactly what you just said. Right, so if the wages change, if the labor productivity changes, if the raw materials change, it's going to affect the graph. It's either going to shift left or right.
Okay.
Second, changes in taxes. Changes in taxes on the supplier. Okay, so reduction in corporate tax or indirect taxes. Okay, but it must relate to the supplier. If the taxes change, so will the demand. So will the supply. We'll talk about supply here, not demand. Okay, number three, change in factor productivity / quality. Changes in quality / productivity. Right, so if our workers become more efficient, can we do more? Yes, we can. Here they're talking about the productivity and the quality of the resources. So, a rise in productivity, labor or capital, will cause an increase in aggregate supply. That just makes more sense. Right, if my workers are producing more, I'm going to obviously create more. Okay, if they're more productive, great. If they're more skilled, great. Okay, so that's what we're looking at here. And also, I could have the same workers producing the same items.
Yeah.
But if they're more skilled and they're more experienced, the quality is going to go up. Okay, that's what they're talking about. Changes in quality / productivity. Okay, so you're looking at two things. You look at how the business responds to workers that are more competent.
Yeah.
Okay, more skilled. And then the last one, changes in the quantity of resources. Changes in quantity of resources. Right, that's very self-explanatory. Okay, quantity of resources refers to how much you've got. The example in the textbook says, in the short run, the supply of inputs may be influenced by supply-side shocks, such as natural disasters. Okay, so a simple example. In terms of supply shocks, okay, when we had the droughts, okay, and we didn't have much water in the country, okay, mainly Cape Town, Western Cape. But did we have as much fruit and vegetables? Probably not. Okay, that would have affected that. That's a supply shock, natural disaster. That's what they talk about here, shocks. Shocks to the quantity of resources.
Okay.
Last bit here is look at the shape of the long run. Okay, so that was shape of the short run. We actually need to put a heading here. Shifts in AS, just in brackets here. Short run shifts. Short run shifts. Because I see they've separated it. Okay, and then we've got long run shifts. And long run shifts. Okay, they've described economic theory here. Do you have that? Oh, here's the thing. Can you pass me that work program?
Yeah.
I just want to see how much detail do you need here, because this is actually quite advanced. So I don't want to confuse you if you don't have to cover this, because short run and long run already is quite complicated to understand. We discussed it, but let's just see if we do need to go into detail here. This is chapter 4. Okay, so there's the government stuff, pricing, okay, so macroeconomy, aggregate demand, okay, we've covered that, aggregate supply, okay, they do look at short run, okay, they do look at long run, all right, we need to look at both. And the shape of the long run, they also talk about the shifts, okay, you do have to cover it. Alicia. All right, so Let's discuss it then. It's quite a long bit here because we're looking at this long-run aggregate supply. Okay, so just tell me in your words, what does long-run aggregate supply refer to?
The changes in the long run, so not now, in the future.
Yes, so have prices been updated?
Yeah.
Yes, okay, so it's not looking at the short changes. Yeah. It's looking at like overall. Okay, good. Okay, so here they say, the long-run aggregate supply curve shows the relation between real GDP and change in price levels where there has been time for input prices to adjust to aggregate demand. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
When output and hence employment are low, firms can attract more resources without raising their prices. There is time for input prices to change due to the low level of aggregate demand. Another group of economists called new classical economists versus Keynes. Okay, so Milton, I think it was Milton Keynes, if I remember correctly from previously. But this is Keynesian.
Okay,
it's a fancy term, refers to Keynes. Keynes was the economist that uncovered this research. Okay, so there's two. Let's write down both of them. Number one, let's just write them down. Keynesium. Keynesium. S-I-A-N-S. Keynesium. Okay? Keynes. Okay, Keynes is the economist's surname. And these are people that follow his philosophy, his teachings. Okay? So, Keynesians often represent the L-R-A-S, so long-run aggregate supply curve, as perfectly elastic. There's the key. Okay, so Keynesian, the LRAS is perfectly elastic. Okay, perfectly elastic. At low levels of output. So maybe I see the ad here. Elastic at low levels of outputs.
Okay.
Then upward sloping over a range of output and finally perfectly elastic. Okay, so perfectly elastic at low levels of output, then upward sloping, and finally inelastic. Okay, so that's what they're using to describe the graph. Okay, perfectly elastic at low levels, then upward sloping, and finally elastic. Okay, have a look at that graph. See, okay, perfectly elastic, then upward sloping, then inelastic. Right, so if I'm looking at a firm producing goods, what is the firm going to be producing? The most or the least? Mostly or hopefully the most, do you agree? Okay, so here they said, as output rises from the one to the other, there could be shortages in inputs and a buildup of wages, raw material prices, and the price of capital equipment. When output reaches Y, the economy is producing the maximum output it can make with existing resources. So here we're looking at production or producing the max amount possible. Okay, as a supplier, you would obviously want to produce the most as you can. Okay, then the next group, new classical economists. Copy this. Okay, what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to delete that bit there. And I'm going to highlight this in one color. And I'm going to put a word here, or. Here's the other view. Right, and this view is looking at the new classical economists. New Classical economists. Okay, different color here. Let's use green. Okay, so what do they believe? Their view. Maybe. Okay, it's Maynard Keynes. Sorry, I said Milton Keynes. It's Milton Friedman, I think it is. Milton Friedman, there's the other guy's name. Maynard Keynes. Okay, Keynesian. Okay, followers of the economic John Maynard Keynes, who maintain that government intervention is needed to achieve full employment. New classical economists, that the LRAS curve is vertical at the end, that the economy will move forwards until employment without government intervention. Okay, so there's two things. Government is going to intervene, or they're not going to intervene. Why does government intervene? We saw it earlier in one of those separate chapters, government intervention. What does government want to do?
Well, they want the best for their country.
Exactly. So government wants these businesses to produce the most they possibly can. All right, so that's just a definition there for the... remember, it's just the underlying principles that do, that describe the aggregate supply graph. Okay, so do you agree these two are different researchers or economists that have come up with economic theory? And that economic theory explains the aggregate supply graph. And here they're looking at the long run and the short run.
Yeah.
Okay, so here I'm looking at long run, and I'm looking at two different views. I'm looking at here, Keynesian, and I'm looking at here, new classical economists. Okay, with this one, I'm looking at long run in terms of perfectly elastic, then upward sloping, then inelastic.
Yeah.
Okay, with new classical, I'm looking at the other thing. Okay, so let's just describe that one. The other group of economists called new classical economists illustrate the LRAS curve as a vertical line. There's it. Okay, so what do? Vertical line. We'll describe why now. Okay, so why is the vertical line? Well, they said the economy will operate at full capacity. This version LRAS curve is shown in 4.6. 4.6 is the new classical long-run aggregate curve line. The distinction between Keynesian and new classical school version of the shape of the LRAS curve can be used and as evaluative point in answering a number of questions. Shifts in the LRAF curve, both Keynesian and new classical economists agree that the causes of the shifts in the LRAS curve are a change in the quantity and the quality of resources. So, vertical line describing the full capacity. Okay, so now we need to look at this again. Okay, so I wrote down here, I'm just going to highlight this. This was shifts in short run. Okay, that's red. Okay, now I'm going to use shifts in long run. Long run. There's only four here. Five. One, two, three, four, five. Six. It's actually six. Okay, so can you fit six somewhere there? Ooh, you run out of space. What are you going to do?
I think I'll just rush in my detailed notes.
Separate?
Yeah.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, you'll have this as well, so
yeah,
that'll help. Okay, so long run shifts. What is a long run shift? It's looking at a shift of the graph when prices have settled, basically.
Yeah.
Okay, the first one is net immigration. If the immigrants are of working age, this will increase the size of the labor force. Okay, so net immigration, brackets, labor force size. That'll shift the graph. Okay, that makes sense. Why? People will produce more when there's more labor. Make sense? Okay, next one, increase in retirement age. Okay, maybe you can read these.
Okay, increase in retirement age. Okay, does that make sense?
Yeah, this will increase the size of the labor force.
Exactly.
A number of countries have raised the age at which people can receive a state pension, and some of these plan to raise it even further in the future.
Good. Okay, so do you agree the longer people work, the more supply we'll have in the system? Okay, because people are working longer instead of retiring. Right, number three?
More women entering the labor force.
Okay, so diversity, more women working. Okay, so previously, obviously, women had specific roles, and that has changed drastically now. So
yeah,
it's a bit outdated. It's not really a very valid point now as things are currently. Okay, but it's a point the textbook mentions. Okay, that one's important. Why?
If gross investments, total investments exceeds depreciation, there will be additions in capital stock.
Good. So investment helps add to the productivity of a business. Do you agree? So if I'm investing, I'm going to have more in terms of capacity. Okay, number five.
Discovery of new resources. Discovery of, for instance, new oil fields or gold mines can increase a country's productive potential.
Okay, good. Factors of production.
Yeah.
Right, so we find new factors of production, cheaper resources, resources we never had before. Is that going to affect supply? Big time. Okay, the last one?
The last one, land reclamation.
Ooh, just say that again.
Reclamation.
Okay, just read the example.
For instance, in recent years, Dubai has added considerably to its land area by reclaiming land,
yes,
on which it has built houses, hotels, minerals, theme parks, and beaches.
Okay, so a bit of a strange one, reclamation. Okay, looking at, spelling.
Reclamation.
Yeah, R-E-C-L-A-M. Okay, like to reclaim something. If you reclaim something, what does that mean?
You take it
back, basically. Okay, so normally during times of war, reclamation would be basically getting back land. Or reclassification. Okay, so if we say this land is available for production. If it's available for production, it's going to give more land to people, businesses that can operate. Make sense? Okay, perfect. Right, I think the summary you can write down in your notes, that you should be able to fit.
Yeah.
Okay, just the interaction between the two. Okay, so you've got the list here of AS and AG, AD and AS. Right, the last bit here is looking at macroeconomic equilibrium. There's a nice graph to put. Right, so let's draw both of them on the same set of axes. Aggregate supply and aggregate demand. Back bracket, macro equilibrium. Okay, that's the last bit here. Okay, so we're looking at equilibrium. We're looking at where the two graphs intersect. Do you agree? Perfect. So let's show the other graph here. We've got aggregate demand and aggregate supply. Ooh, I need to relabel these graphs. See, I made a mistake there. Supply. Just change the label. Supply. Supply, and then this one is supply and demand. Okay, so demand is blue.
I wrote down the definition for this.
Perfect.
Okay, so supply we know slopes up, demand we know slopes down. Where they intersect, that's called equilibrium. Okay, so equilibrium is where those two lines cross. And here, they spoke about key concepts, equilibrium and efficiency. The section above refers to macroeconomic equilibrium. Economists study what the current macroeconomic equilibrium is, why it has changed in recent times, and what the desired level of macroeconomic equilibrium would be. Okay, why would you do that? You're looking at the market holistically. So, just to add some notes here, equilibrium for the market as a whole provides economists with an idea of where the desired level of equilibrium should be. Inverted commas, it's an expectation. Right, so you'll kind of know where to produce goods based on its estimated market equilibrium.
Okay,
now we've got completely new topics. You still okay?
Yeah. I think I'm gonna go get my juice.
Okay. Okay, this is still looking at macroeconomics, but it's not looking at aggregate demand and supply. That's out. Key heading here is this whole concept of inflation. Okay, so inflation is a very easy concept to understand, and we've actually discussed it before.
Yeah.
What is inflation?
It's when prices are higher.
When? Now or in the future?
Future?
In the future, there's it. Okay, so what is inflation? Let's define it. Increasing prices over time. That's what you're looking at. Okay, you get different types of inflation. The textbook goes in a lot of detail. They talk about creeping inflation, hyperinflation, cost push inflation, there's a lot. Okay, but as long as you keep it simple, what is inflation? Increasing prices over time. That's all it is. Okay, so over time, prices will go up. Generally. Not always. Generally. They say degrees of inflation. So there are different ways of increasing prices over time. So number one, A. Degrees of inflation. Okay, you get creeping inflation versus hyperinflation. Okay, those are the two different types. Okay, something is creeping. Creeping means it slowly increases over time. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Hyper. Something is hyper. It's fast. It's changing very quickly. And that's the difference here. Okay, so creeping inflation is a low rate of inflation sustained over a certain period of time. Hyperinflation is exceptionally high rates of inflation over a small period of time. Okay, so creeping inflation, brackets, gradual, comma, low rates of inflation over a period of time. Hyperinflation in brackets, exceptional inflation. Exception, I think they use the word exceptionally high. Yes, exceptionally high levels or rates of inflation. Rates of inflation over a shorter period of time. Okay, so do we want prices to increase? No, we don't. Okay, ideally you actually want prices to stay the same. And that's why government has something called inflation targeting. You've probably heard them talk about that on the news or not. Okay, but the Reserve Bank is required to manage inflation. That's what they're required to do. What do I mean by manage inflation? They need to try to control it as much as possible using the tools that they have. Okay, two, measuring inflation. Okay, they say a country's price levels indicate how much it costs to live in that country. A rise in price levels means the cost of living has increased. So how do we measure inflation? We take a base year and we compare future prices to that year. Okay, example. If we had prices in 2000, comma, we could compare all future prices to that 1 year, to that year. Okay, that's how you measure it. Right, so inflation is always measured by comparing year on year. Okay, last year compared to this year. Last year compared to this year. Last year compared to this year over a longer period of time. Does it make sense? Right, how do they get the data? They have to survey and they have to get information. Okay, that creates a consumer price index. That's the most important measure of inflation. Consumer price index. Bracket CPI. This is the average inflation for a country. Okay, they don't have to say for anything. Average inflation. Okay, we know inflation is rising of prices over time. Okay, that's very important. CPI. Make sure you know what CPI is. Okay, if you listen to the news, they talk about CPI every month. They talk about the monthly CPI. Have prices increased this month compared to last month? And if it has, by how much? Okay, so inflation, just to recap, inflation is two types. Creeping means slow, hyper means fast. How do we measure it? We use CPI, a consumer price index. What does that mean? We look at a base year and we look year on year. That's what we're looking at. And that's it. That's the important bit there. Okay, there's an example here which we'll look at. A little bit of maths. And then we need to look at causes and consequences and factors. Those are the last ones.
Okay, now I'm just like consumer price index, this is average.
Yeah, that's the most important measure. If we're looking at measuring inflation, you have to know that, CPI. Those two go together. How do we measure inflation? CPI.
Okay.
Got that. Okay, here's an example. Let's do one here at the bottom. E.g. The price of item A in 2000 was 20 Rand. And in 2008 or 2001, let's use more recent years actually. Why not? Okay. 2017, 2018. Okay, the price of item A in 2017 was 20, and in 2018 it was 24. What is the CPI? Or what is the inflation? Let's use that rather. Inflation, question mark, let's do the working at the bottom. Okay, so what am I working out here? Consumer price, inflation, I'm working as a base year. Okay, so the base year could be anything. I mean, the base year we could look at, and maybe let me add to the question here. The base year price was in 2000. At, let's say, 5 Rand. What is the inflation? And what is the CPI? Okay, so let's look at the two things. So let's start with inflation. 2017 to 2018, inflation rate is... How would you calculate that? Mathematics.
24 minus
20. Good. Gives you the difference, right? 24 minus 20 gives you the difference. Divide by what?
Divide by the number is?
No. Divide by the starting point, 20. Times 100. Okay, on your calculator. Calculator. What does that give us? Four over 20 is 105, should be 20%, I think. Okay, so 24 minus 20 equals 4. 4 divided by 20 equals 20 times 100 equals 20%. 20%. Okay, so that's the inflation rate from 2017 to 2018. Got that? Okay, CPI is... Brackets. What price do I have now?
24.
Divided by what price do I have?
20.
In 2000?
20.
5.
Over.
Close brackets. Okay, it gives you an answer. 24 divided by 25. 24
divided by
5. Divided by 5, sorry, yeah. Is 4.8. 4.8. Right, so if the base is 2000. The price in 2018 is 4.8 times as much compared to 2000. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the one is represented as a number and the one is represented as a fraction. Okay, but it's all the same thing. It's just looking at a change in price.
If you can do basic maths, you should be able to do that.
Okay.
Okay, so what does CPI do? It compares it to a base. It's an index. Then the last bit here, okay, we've done that, we've done the working. Monetary values versus real values. Okay, that's something to describe as well here. Let's write a note about that.
Is it a new heading?
No, still inflation. Just a new topic underneath it. So, real versus monetary values. Real versus monetary values. Is there a difference?
Yeah.
Yes. Money means, what is it worth? Now, in money terms. Okay, so you might have the bottle of water costing 10 rand. Okay, in money terms. But in terms of real value,
how much it costs to produce?
No. Real value is looking at the inflation. Okay, so adjusted for inflation, that's what you're looking at. Okay, so the bottle could have been worth 5 rand, okay, 5 years ago. The real value of the real value of the bottle would be adjusted for inflation. Okay, so just a note here. Real values are adjusted for inflation. Monetary values are just that, monetary values. Values the prices at a specific point in time.
Can I read those?
Yeah. That's exactly what we just said.
Okay, so real values adjusted.
Yeah, so the one you adjust for inflation, the one is just, what is it now? Real versus monetary.
Values at the prices over time. What did you say there? Values at the prices?
Values at the prices operating at the time. Okay, point number four under this whole heading of inflation, causes. Right, so what causes it? Well, there's a few things. I'm sure you can probably think of some already, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why would prices go up? Basic.
I don't know. It's just one thing.
The costs. Costs push inflation. Right, so cost push inflation means the cost push up the prices. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Right, that's cost push inflation. Inflation caused by increases in cost of production. That's what they describe there. Increased costs of production increase prices. Okay, B. Demand pull. Demand pull inflation. Right, consumers drive up the prices. Okay, think of an auction, e.g. an auction. Okay, have you seen an auction before?
Yeah.
Okay, this bottle of water starts at 1 rand. Who wants it? Everybody puts up their hand. Okay, can I have 2 rand? Someone says yes. Can I have 3 rand? Someone says yes. And they keep going and going and going and going and going until the last person that bids gets the bottle of water. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, that's an auction. Why? It's demand pull. So the customers, the consumers, the buyers, they're the ones determining what the price is. Okay, so those are those two there. The others...
Okay, monetarists. That's a strange term. First time I'm seeing it here. This is actually something slightly different, but it's fine. Monetarist. Okay, they give it to you here. Okay, another cause of inflation. Okay, monetarists are going to be looking at the money supply. Okay, so it's a little bit more advanced, which you'll actually look at in more detail later on when we talk about government's macro intervention. Okay, remember that last chapter we need to look at?
Yeah.
The heading is government's macro intervention. It talks about that in a lot more detail.
Okay.
Right, so monetarists, money supply will affect market prices. The amount of money in the system will affect the goods and services, the pricing of available goods and services. That's what you're looking at there. Okay, and those are the three. The last bit is just the consequences, and then deflation versus disinflation. Okay, just the definition of those two. Okay, so causes we've done, I'm going to write this on a new page again. Okay, so on this page, now we can label it number 5. Consequences. Consequences of inflation. Right, the first one, reduction in net exports. Okay, that's logical. Obviously, the higher the prices, the less I'm going to export. Straightforward. B, unplanned redistribution of income. Unplanned redistribution of income. Okay, again, pretty straightforward. Right, if I'm looking at the unplanned redistribution of income, redistribution of income meaning some people will gain, some people will lose. Okay, in relation to inflation, that's what they described here. Right, so for example, if I increase certain items in terms of price, right, certain people will be affected, not others. Right, so for example, if we increase the price of bread and milk, that's going to affect everyone, okay, because most people buy bread and milk. If I increase the prices of laptops and computers and PCs, right, that's not going to affect everyone. Okay, it'll only affect people looking at buying laptops and PCs and printers and so on. Okay, number C, they talk about menu costs. Think about a restaurant. A restaurant offers you a menu. Here, they look at the consequences of inflation. So one of the consequences is that these affect firms that are the cost, these affect firms and are the costs involved in changing prices. So if the price of the menu had to change every day, what is the restaurant going to have to do? Print out a new menu every day. And that's bad. See, that's a consequence. Okay, so menu costs, brackets, changing the advertised price. Okay, and that's a pain. And that's why government is trying to keep prices as consistent as possible. Right, because imagine if every day there was a new price for a certain item in the store. That would be crazy. Okay, you go today, you go tomorrow, and there are two different prices. Okay, that actually what happens in Zimbabwe. Well, when they had hyperinflation. Right now, things are kind of improving because they had a change in government.
Yeah.
Okay, but people literally didn't know what prices of different goods were because it was one price today and another price tomorrow. Very, very bad consequence. D. Okay, they talk about shoe leather costs. Okay, I don't know where they get these fancy terms from, but okay, shoe leather obviously refers to like something that's made from leather. Okay, these are the costs involved in moving money from one financial institution to another in search of a higher rate of interest. Okay, I don't know how shoe leather cost relates to that. Okay, very, very weird description to describe that. Okay, but we'll use it because that's how they describe it. That's some economists probably uncovered and they like shoes and they decided to call it the shoe leather cost. Okay, there's probably some backstory to it, but we don't have the detail in the textbook. They just say, costs involved in moving
money from one financial institution to another that gives higher rates of interest. Okay, so as a person that's saving, obviously you want the most interest on your money as possible. And that's what they're referring to. Okay, that one is a difficult one to remember. I mean, shoe leather costs. At least like menu costs is easy to remember, but shoe leather, ooh, I don't know how you're gonna remember that. Okay, think of some fancy creative way of doing it. Just a note about this in the exam. I doubt the examiner is gonna ask you for all of them.
Yeah.
Alright, they're always going to ask you maybe give 2, give 3, give 4. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 different consequences and benefits.
Yeah.
Alright, so I doubt they'll want all, but as long as you know most of them, that helps. Okay. As an examiner, it would be unfair to ask for all of them. They would only ask you for some. Alright, fiscal drag. Fiscal drag. Okay, this is quite an easy one to remember because you think of the word fiscal. Fiscal refers to the government, okay, the country. So here they said, this is now sometimes referred to as bracket creep. This is looking at different tax rates. So fiscal drag, or I'm going to put another word there, or inverted commas, they call this bracket creep. Okay, this is people paying different amounts of tax. Will obviously be affected by different changes in prices. Right, so here they said certain goods will be affected by inflation rather than others. This will affect different individuals rather than others. Right, then you've got discouragement of investment, that's F. Discouragement of investment. Discouragement of investment means exactly that. People don't want to invest. Why don't they want to invest? Because they believe prices will increase over time. Okay, so if I would be worried to invest in a business if prices keep going up and up and up and up. Okay, it's very, very risky. Right, you can even add that as a consequence, risk. They don't actually mention risk here, which is unusual. The next one. Inflationary noise. Okay, inflationary noise, this one we can describe. They talk about money illusion. Okay, the rising prices over time create confusion because price signals are communicated to the consumers and firms have to increase prices and more expensive relative to other products. Indeed, products may have risen but in price by less than inflation, and so may have become relatively cheaper. Inflationary noise can result in consumers and firms making the wrong decisions. So inflationary noise, best way to describe that, mixed. Mixed inflation for different goods creates confusion. Okay, that's like the price of milk going up, but not bread. Okay, so now, do we have inflation or don't we? If milk's going up, will the price of bread go up? Are they linked, or is that something that we need to be concerned with? Okay, because that's a consequence. Right, so now you might say, well, okay, if this is going up, well, this must also go up. It's a consequence, inflationary noise. And then the last one in terms of consequence is inflation causing inflation. Inflation causing inflation. Right, so inflation is the rising of prices over time. So if I'm going to increase the prices of my goods, are the prices of wages going to go up? Yes. Okay, that's what they're looking at, the spillover effects. If one thing goes up, it spills over to another. Okay, then we just need one point over here about should have been 6. Sorry, I labeled these incorrectly. Okay, and this should be 7. Okay, there's only 3 here. This one's short.
What is this for?
Benefits. So we had consequences, now we just need benefits. There's just 3 of them. Okay, the first benefit is stimulating output. Right, i.e. producing more. The second one is reduce the burden of debt. Okay, what do we mean by reducing the burden of debt? This one's quite an interesting one because they talk about the real interest rates. Okay, so if a real interest rate may fall due to inflation or may even become negative, this is because nominal rates do not tend to rise in line with inflation. And as a result, debt burdens may fall. For example, those who have borrowed money to buy a house may experience a fall in their mortgage payments in real terms. Right, so reducing burden of debt, I'm just going to put a note here. House increases in value, debt or interest on debt stays the same. Right, so obviously you want your house to increase in price, do you? The more the house is worth, the better. Okay, because that increases your asset value, and then obviously reduces your debt, because then you should hopefully be able to pay it back, depending on the situation. Okay, and then the last one here, C, prevents some employment. Preventing employment would be bad. Unemployment. I read it wrong. Prevents some unemployment. Firms in difficulties may have to reduce their costs to survive. For many firms, wages form a significant portion of their total cost. With zero inflation, firms may have to cut their labor force. However, inflation would enable them to reduce their real cost of labor by either keeping nominal wages constant or by not raising them in line with inflation. Right, so prevents some employment.
House increase in value, interest on debt, same the same.
Stays the same. Sorry, typo. Stays the same. Yeah, so I wrote the same twice. Okay. And then the last bit on inflation is just these two concepts, factors, effects, and consequences. We looked at that. So we just needed to find these last two things. Okay, so on this page, deflation equals, okay, these are definitions. Deflation is a sustained decrease in price over time. Right, so as much as we can have inflation, we can also have deflation, where prices of goods actually decrease, not increase. It doesn't happen that often, but it can. And the last one is disinflation. That's the final one. Disinflation. Okay, what is that definition? A fall in the inflation rates.
Are we going to speak more about these topics or not?
No, that's the end, yeah. A fall in inflation rates. Okay, so those are the two topics, last two topics here that relate to inflation. So maybe just to highlight these on this, because it's all on the same page, I just want to quickly do this, okay, and this. Okay, so inflation, increasing price over time, deflation, decreasing prices over time, disinflation, we have inflation, but the rate has fallen. Okay, so we still have it, but it's just not as problematic. And that ends that bit. They did talk about causes and consequences of deflation. So I just want to quickly highlight that while we've got the page here. They say deflation will increase the burden of debt. It may increase
the real rate of interest and result in menu costs. It's heavily influenced by the cause of deflation. Economists refer to good deflation and bad deflation. So this could be seen as a slow economy. It could be seen as a recession. So next to deflation, I just want to put a note here, asterisk, possible recession. Recession means the company's in a bad situation. Okay, because if the economy is growing, you would obviously expect prices to increase, not decrease. So deflation, as much as we would like prices to decrease, isn't the best thing for the country, because that shows the country might be in a recession. Okay, and that completes that. So balance of payments will start on Wednesday. So please remember to bring economics and business on Wednesday. At least we can just wrap up this chapter. This chapter is quite long. And then we've got that one short one left, and that covers all the theory. Okay?
So then on Monday we should finish the theory for economics,
definitely.
Okay, so then that's
one. Yeah, definitely.